to First Presbyterian Church. My name is Pastor Annie, and we want to give you an especially warm welcome for tuning in on our online services. Today is the fifth Sunday of Easter, and it is Mother's Day. So today we want to celebrate mothers. So happy Mother's Day to all of you out there. I do have a couple announcements I would like to make that are not reflected in your bulletin. And if you have not had a chance, and this is new to you, to tune in, on our website, you can download our worship bulletin just like this and follow along. And we would love for you to do that. And also, at the end of the service, there will be a special song, and we have the words printed in the bulletin, so you might want to look at that as well. Okay, so announcements. One, Meals on Wheels. This church is responsible for the month of June for delivering Meals on Wheels to the folks in the community who have a hard time getting out. And they are asking us to sign up, and we have 2 weeks, the first 2 weeks already signed up. We now need the second 2 weeks. So if you feel like you can deliver to the folks in this community who could really use a meal, we would love for you to join us. Email Crystal and let her know what dates you can do that. And again, that's the last two weeks of June. Also, as you deliver, you know, you can wear a mask, you can wear gloves, you can take the precautions that we would want you to take in order to feel comfortable. So with that said, and I said happy Mother's Day, I think that's all the announcements I have today. So let us take a moment and prepare our hearts for worship. Hear these words from the Gospel of John, chapter 14. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Please join me in our call to worship. Welcome home, people of God.
We have come to find refuge in the shelter of God's care.
Come and sit down. There is room for everyone in God's home.
We have come to be nourished by God's word.
We are God's own people and are precious in God's sight.
We have come to give thanks for God's faithful love.
Let us pray together. Loving, compassionate Father, as a mother hen gathers her chicks, so you draw the whole family to yourself. Bring us together now, Lord, that we may today and forever be united under your wing in all our sorrows and joys. Amen. We now come to the time of the service where we enter into a corporate confession. And though that we are not all here in the sanctuary, we still join together in spirit. And it says in the Bible that when two or more are gathered, Jesus is present. And so we claim that presence with all of us now, and we come together and we confess all the ways in which we build walls, the walls that keep us from being in relationship with one another, the walls that keep us not in relationship with God, from unforgiveness to judgment to stereotypes, we all build walls. So we come together and we acknowledge all the ways in which we do this. But we do so in confidence because we know that Jesus is the wall breaker. And that by doing so, by confessing our sin, that Jesus breaks down those walls, that he gives us eyes to see, and hearts to receive. With this in mind, please join me in our prayer of confession. Together. Holy One, you are our fortress and our rock, the foundation on which all things are built. You have made us one family and one people, a holy priesthood, precious in your sight. Yet we often pursue our own plans. And ignore your designs for our lives. We reject those who are different from us and build walls that separate us from each other and from you. Forgive us, O God. Tear down the barriers we have put up and rescue us from isolation. Amen. Let us take a moment and make this prayer our own. Amen. Hear these words of assurance. Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb? As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, says the Lord.
Praise be to God. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is from the Old Testament, the book of Genesis, chapter 29, verses 15 to 35. Hear the word of the Lord. Then Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Hold on, let me see if I read that right. Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It is better that I give her to you than I should give her to any other man stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife that I may go into her, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went into her. Laban gave his maid Zilpah to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah. And Jacob said to Laban, "What is this that you have done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Why then have you deceived me?" Laban said, "This is not done in our country, giving the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years." Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. Laban gave his maid Bilhah to his daughter Rachel to be her maid. So Jacob went in to Rachel also, and he loved Rachel more than Leah. He served Laban for another 7 years. When the Lord saw that Leah was unloved, and he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren, Leah conceived and bore a son, and she named him Reuben. For she said, "Because the Lord has looked on my affliction, surely now my husband will love me." She conceived again and bore a son and said, "Because the Lord has heard that I am hated, he has given me this son also." And she named him Simon. Again, she conceived and bore a son. "And now this time my husband will be joined to me, because I have born him three sons." Therefore, he was named Levi. She conceived again and bore a son and said, "This time I will praise the Lord." Therefore, she named him Judah. Then she ceased bearing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can gather together this morning. Though all of us in our separate dwellings, we are all connected. And we are all in this season together with the pandemic, and all of us are dealing with it in different ways and struggling with it at different levels. So we pray that you will meet each and every one of us, that you would unload us of our burdens and replace it with your yoke, that you would give us eyes to see and hearts to receive your message this morning. We pray that through this message that you would touch our hearts deeply, that we would know the hope that we have in you, and we would stand on the promise that Jesus is the truth, the way, and the life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Colleen Mastany wrote The Baby Whisperer in the Chicago Tribune in February 2013. Becky O'Connell had been given a unique unofficial title, The Baby Whisperer. Officially, the 65-year-old woman is a temporary foster care worker. According to a 2013 article in the Chicago Tribune, she keeps baby clothes arranged by size in the guest room. The hand-knit caps are stacked by a table near the door, and the white wicker bassinet is always within reach. Becky O'Connell is prepared because at any moment of the day or night, she could receive a call from a worker, from a social worker who needs to place an infant in her care. Some of the children have been abandoned. Others have been abused. All of them are desperate for love, for touch, for attention. So far, Ms. O'Connell has taken in 77 infants, and that was in 2013, or about 7 babies per year that stay from 1 night to 4 months. The road to this unique call wasn't easy. In 1999, her youngest son, Ian, was killed in a car accident. And she says, quote, "For years and years after his death, I couldn't concentrate," she says. "I looked and act like a normal person, but you don't feel like a normal person." A few years later, she was just beginning to regain her balance. She read an ad from a local adoption agency. They needed someone to be a temporary foster parent for newborns. To O'Connell, who had always loved babies, it sounded like a dream job. If she had a secret, she says, it is simply giving each child her undivided attention. She adds, quote, "People think that babies bring a lot of disorder and confusion to a household," she says, "but I'm here to tell you, it's not the babies who are disordered and confused, it's the adults." O'Connell simply says, quote, "My job is to fall in love with these babies," end quote. I want to read something again when she says, "It is not the babies who are disordered and confused. It is the adults." Today I want to talk about a story in the Bible, a story where the adults are very much disordered and confused. And hopefully as we journey through the story, we can find ourselves a bit in it. For this story is about Jacob and about Leah and Rachel and Laban. Now, to understand this story, we need to understand a little bit of the backstory. Jacob was the son of Rebekah and Isaac, and Jacob had a brother, Esau. And if you are familiar with the stories previous to what we read, you know that Esau and Jacob as brothers were always at each other's throats, and it's because Jacob was always lying, stealing, and cheating his brother out of something. And so because of this, there was a lot of strife between the brothers. And at one point in their story, Jacob and his mother, Rebekah, do stuff so that he can steal Esau's blessing from his father when his father was dying. Now, the blessings were really important, and once somebody spoke a blessing over you, that's what would happen. And so what Isaac did is he dressed up as Esau. His mother directed him to do so. He made a special dish for his father because his father was blind. And so when he went in, he said, "I am Esau." And even when Jacob questioned and said, "You don't sound like Esau," Jacob's like, "But I am." And so Isaac gives him Esau's blessing. And Esau finds out about this, and it's one of many things that happened between them. And Esau is so angry, and he goes to his father saying, "Give me the blessing." And his father's like, "I can't give you the blessing. I gave it to your brother." So Esau is enraged. And so Rebekah, Jacob's mother, tells Jacob, "You must flee, run to Laban's house, a distant relative, because Esau will kill you. And so Jacob runs to Laban's house, and Laban puts him to work in his cattle. And what happens is that Jacob is working for Laban, and Laban goes to Jacob and says, you know, we don't want you to work for free, which seems like a really great moment here. Like Laban wants to be fair. We don't want you to work for free, and this is my paraphrase. What are your wages? What do you want to work for? Well, Jacob had seen Laban's daughters, Leah and Rachel. Now, Leah was the oldest one, and in all the other translations, but the one I read this morning, which kind of threw me, says that Leah was described as having weak eyes. And what that meant, many commentators said it, is that she was not attractive. She was the ugly duckling. And that nobody wanted her, whether it was because her eyes were crossed or we just don't know. We don't know exactly what that means, except that it's negative. But Jacob had eyes for Rachel, and they describe Rachel as beautiful. And so he says, I want to marry your daughter Rachel, who is the youngest. And Laban says, work for me for 7 years, and I will give you Rachel as your wife. And he doesn't say, I will give her to you. Actually, what Laban says is, it's better for you to have her than some other man. So, and I'm going to put a pin in that because I'm going to come back to that. So Jacob works for 7 years, and on the completion of that 7 years, which scripture says it felt like days to him because of his love for Rachel, he goes to Laban and says, give me my wife so I can lie with her and I can start my family. And so Laban has this idea. He's going to cheat Jacob out of that right initially by giving him Leah. And what we can best deduce from this scripture is that the wedding lasted for a week, and at some point Leah was given to Jacob, but she must have had something over her because Jacob did not recognize her, and he lied with her. And then when he woke up and saw that he was with Leah, he was outraged. He had been snookered by Laban. Kind of fitting if you think about it, because Jacob's name means the deceiver, and here he has been deceived by Laban. And can you imagine what Leah must be feeling at this point? Like, poor girl, that she's not very attractive. People know that, and Jacob has made it known, I don't want her. I want Rachel. So what Laban does is he says, it's not customary for us to give you our younger daughter before the older daughter. So that's custom. But I tell you what, work 7 more years and I will give you Rachel. And so Jacob, out of his love for Rachel, agrees to it. And so now you have the story of one husband and two wives. And these two wives are sisters. And it's been a rocky start. And so Leah knows she's kind of the unwanted one, but God sees her pain and hears her cry. And the scripture says God saw that she was not loved. And so God opens her womb and she conceives a son, and her first son she names Reuben. And she says this, she says, now that I have conceived a son, I will name him Reuben, which means I am seen. So now that I have this son, Jacob will see me, and he will love me. She then has a second son, and she names him, I want to say Simon. And Simon means to be heard, which means now my husband will hear me and love me. So we know that the first son did not bring the love that Leah wanted from Jacob. So now perhaps a second son named Simon will bring the love that she wants, because she's hoping that Jacob will hear her. She has a third son, and she named him Levi. And the Hebrew meaning of that name is attached. So what she's saying in this moment is Surely in this third son, my husband will attach himself to me and will love me. And what we find is Jacob is not responding, or what we can infer is that that love is not coming. And so she has a fourth son. She has Judah. And it changes for her in this moment. So instead of saying, now my husband will love me, she is now saying, now I will praise the Lord. And she names him Judah, and Judah means praise. And let me put a mark in that, that Judah is the beginning of the line to Jesus. So through this outcast woman, through this woman that nobody wanted, including Jacob, through this woman, God brings the line of Jesus. It's the gospel right there. But then we have Rachel, of course, and we don't hear much of Rachel in the section that I read. And if you continue to read, you find that there is so much discord between Rachel and Leah. There is so much strife, and Rachel is bitter because she doesn't have children, so she goes around and gives him her maidservant and starts having children through them because she's desperate to have children. But guess what? After each child, each woman did not find the happiness that they wanted. This story really speaks to our daily lives because it asks us, where are we putting our hope? Jacob was putting his hope in marrying Rachel. Well, when that turned out to be a disappointment because he got Leah first, Leah was putting her hope in Jacob. And Rachel was putting her hope in having children. They were putting their hope in something that would disappoint. And they got the disappointment that life can bring when there is so much strife. So my question to you is, where are you putting your hope? Where today, in the hopes that you have for the immediate future, what are those hopes lie in? Do they lie in a person? Do they lie in a thing? Do they lie in something or a job? Or what is it that you are hoping for? And what happens if that hope doesn't come to pass? Will you, like Leah, get to the place where you can praise the Lord? It is a question that each of us may ask. Another thing we must learn from the story is that God uses shady people. And Laban and Jacob are two of the shadiest people you can find in the Old Testament at this point. But then the story goes on and there are more shady people that come. And God uses them, meaning that God will use people very broken, very shady, very not having your intentions, good intentions for you people in your life. For if it wasn't for Laban giving Jacob Leah, would we have the line of Jesus? Because it's through this deceiving act that Jesus comes, the line of Jesus begins. God uses people in our life. Who in your life would you rather put to the side, or you'd rather avoid, or whatever that may be? Could God be using that person in your life? For Romans 8 says, for God will bring good things for those who love him. He will work for good things. The third thing we need to get from this story is don't miss the blessing in front of you. This is the tragedy of this story, is that Leah loved her husband, Jacob. And each time she had a son, she's like, maybe he'll love me now. Maybe he'll love me now. And if he had eyes to see and a heart to receive, perhaps he would have found happiness that he never thought he'd have. For she was a devoted wife who loved him. And yet, he was so focused on what he wanted that he couldn't see the blessing before him. And that is so true for each and every one of us in our lives today as we so strive for whatever we want, the goals we want, what blessings might we be missing that are right in front of us that may not come in the right package or what we think is the right package. Leah wasn't Rachel, but boy, Leah loved Jacob. Is it possible that you're missing out on a blessing that's right in front of you because you are so focused on something else that you want? And I have two more quick points. Number four, pick your dysfunction. As we see in this story, Jacob comes from a very dysfunctional family with his father Isaac and Rebecca and his brother Esau, and there was a lot of manipulating and deceiving going on. Well, let's not be surprised that now he starts his own family and there is so much strife between the sisters, and Jacob is not helping matters by living as if he does not want Leah. And so the pattern continues. And just so you know, Leah and Rachel's children will grow up and hate each other. Hence, that's where we get the story Joseph. And Joseph's brothers trying to sell him and getting rid of him and deceiving their father. That's coming up pretty soon out of Leah and Rachel's children. Dysfunction continues. And let's be honest, all of us come from dysfunctional families, right? To lesser, greater degrees. And what I tell people, especially when I'm counseling for marriage counseling, is I say, pick the best that you've inherited from your family and choose what you leave behind. Choose the things that were not helpful to you, perhaps. Maybe a lack of communication. Maybe yelling as communication. Maybe living for money or whatever and having that focus and not focus on the family. Whatever it is, I don't know. What is it in your families that you've been given, because we all learn and we all live what we learn, what is it that you would prefer to leave behind? That you can recognize, I got this from my family. Now I am holding it and I am living it out like they were living. It could be subtle, it could be little, it could be big. But God is the pattern breaker. And he desires to break patterns in our lives that are not healthy. And finally, the fifth point, and this is really important, especially for you men. So listen up, because it is Mother's Day, I want mothers to hear this. Women live under so much shame. We have been programmed from the very early pages, from the very beginning. We have been programmed to be a certain way, to live a certain way, to look a certain way, to perform a certain way, to be good enough. And let me tell you, 90, if not more, percent women live with this internal dialogue that says, I am not enough. I am not enough as a mother. I am not enough as a grandmother. I am not enough because I'm not married. I am not enough in my job. I am not enough, because that is what we've been programmed to believe. And that we have to keep working harder to be enough. Well, men, guess what? You guys have the power to give the gift of the women in your life to dismantle those lies, that shame. And don't wait for them to tell you, like, hey, this is my shame. This is the lie in which I live under, because a lot of women can't even name it. But let me tell you, they live it. So I encourage you men this week and the weeks beyond to go to the women in your lives, be intentional, daughters, wives, friends, whatever, and be their greatest cheerleader and tell them you are good enough and beyond. You are a child of God. You are loved. Whatever it is that you can speak into their life with no but, with no extra, you are beautiful and amazing because you are an amazing creation of God. You can help change the world just by doing that. And I do point out mothers and women today because it is Mother's Day, but I am very aware that men have an internal dialogue as well that they live under that is not helpful, that is steeped in shame. And so women can do the same for men. And I do want to encourage you, don't wait, or maybe be bold. Ask your spouse, ask your friend, ask whoever in your life, what is it that you live under? What is the lies that you live under? What do you believe about yourself internally? And then speak the truth to replace that lie, and do it continuously, because we all know hearing truth once does not bring healing to the deepest parts within us. We need to hear it over and over again. Women are programmed. So my question to all of you is, what is your internal dialogue and what shame do you live with? And I end with this story by Janelle Williams Paris. It, quote, "When Mother's Day is Hard," or titled, "When Mother's Day is Hard." And she wrote this in May 2004. "A quick look at our culture shows that idealized images of motherhood are inaccurate, and scripture reveals the same. Ruth was left childless and widowed at a young age. Rachel, Hannah, and Sarah were infertile. Eve and Mary lost sons under terrible circumstances. Two mothers of two kings encouraged their sons to be wicked and unjust. The prodigal son acted with terrible disrespect toward his parents. Scripture tells stories like those in our churches, women in diverse circumstances, sometimes thriving, sometimes coping, and sometimes going under. The fairy tale of marriage and motherhood is just that, a fairy tale. Our culture is one of motherhood deferred due to later childbearing, motherhood disrupted by divorce, motherhood lost by infant child death and miscarriage, and motherhood unachieved due to infertility and undesired singleness. Of course, our culture also includes wonderful families with strong marriages and happy children. The point is that there is not a one-size-fits-all journey of womanhood, and we hurt women in our churches by venerating one path over all others. So let's be gentle with each other this Mother's Day. Let's celebrate with the women who have happy families. Let's remember the women, men, girls, and boys who are hurt by their mothers. Let's remember the mothers who have lost their children. Let's remember the women who long to be wives and mothers but aren't. Let's come together and worship Jesus alone. Let us come together and praise Jesus alone, not idealized images of our mothers and ourselves. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this story. We thank you that the story speaks so much into our lives. And there is so much more that we can take out of this story. So I pray that you would put it on our hearts, those things that you want us to meditate on, to ruminate, to carry with us this week. We pray that you would open our eyes to the blessings in front of us. We pray that you would open our eyes to what you are doing in our midst, even though we have so many hopes and dreams that we're holding on dear in our hearts. We pray that you would give us eyes to see you in the midst, and that in the end we will praise you alone, and that we will not put our hope in people and children and grandchildren or whatever we're hoping in our lives, but that we put our hope in you, and that it's okay to hope for things, but not so okay that we hold on so tightly that we become despairing. So we pray that you would identify the moments in our lives where we are hoping in someone or something else. And we pray in turn that we will respond in our spirit and put our eyes on you and give you our praise and thanks. We pray for all mothers today on Mother's Day. We pray that you would be with them, whether they have children, whether they don't, whether they are married, or whether they are single, because we know that single women play such a strong role in the children, in the lives of the children around us. We pray that you will be with them, that you will continue to lift them up and speak truth into their lives to replace the shame in which they walk. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Myra will now bless us by singing "My Jesus, I Love Thee."
My Jesus, I love Thee. I know You are mine. thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, it is now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, it is mansions of glory and endless delight. I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my
Let us pray. Loving God, we give thanks today for mothers. Thank you for mothers who gave birth to us and women who have treated us as their own. You teach us how to be good mothers, cherishing and protecting the children among us. Help us mother lovingly, fairly, wisely, and with great joy. Help us raise our children to be the people they are born to be. We need your comfort here today, Lord, because some are missing mothers, some are missing children, some are parted by great distance or death. Comfort those who have given up their child for adoption, or who chose not to give birth and have an abortion. Comfort those who longed to be biological mothers and could not. We pray for those whose mothers have disappointed them. We ask for grace in relationships where there is pain and bitterness, for healing in relationships where there is abuse and violence. Help our congregation to be a space where people can feel mothered, their gifts and talents appreciated and nurtured. Finally, we pray today for mothers around the world, mothers who cannot feed their children, mothers who are homeless or without a homeland, mothers who must teach their children about the dangers of bombs and bullets. Help us create a world where mothers can raise their children in peace and plenty. God of mothers who created mothers, who came as a child and had a mother. God, our mother, loving us with a sweeter and deeper love than we have ever known, hear our prayer this day as we pray for those within our community that need your loving touch. Russ Voorhees, Barb Furman, Midge Albert, and Sam Hunt, and all those who are on our hearts today. Bring healing to them. We continue to pray for the coronavirus, those who are sick with it, those who are battling it on the battle lines, those seeking a vaccine. Bring healing and an end to this virus. Lord,
hear our prayers.
And we pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We come to the time of our service where we would normally take up an offering, and I want to encourage all of you to continue to send in your offerings, and for those of you who do, we want to give you a big thank you. But when we take up an offering, what we are saying is that we believe in Jesus Christ, that we believe he is moving and moving mountains, not only in our lives, but in the lives of those in this community and in this world. We believe that through these gifts that we give, that it furthers Jesus's good news in others' lives. And that by giving of our gifts, that we partner with him, and that we help bring restoration and peace to those who desperately need it. So let us praise Jesus alone by giving of our gifts today. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all the ways in which you provide for us, from family and friends to the resources that bless our lives. We pray that the gifts that we give today would bless others in this community and in this world, for there is so much need. And we pray that as these gifts reach those who are in need, that it will speak to them more than just relief of their situation, but it would speak to them that you are alive and well, that you call them by name, that you hear their cry, and that you desire to be alive and well in their life. We pray that you would open their hearts and that you would give them the boldness to respond. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Receive the blessing. May the Lord, who brought us to birth by his Spirit, strengthen us for the Christian life. May the Lord, who provides for all our needs, sustain us day by day. May the Lord, whose steadfast love is constant as a mother's care, send us out to live and work for others. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. And now I leave you with this prayer.
What is the best kept secret to becoming a great singer?
Technical difficulties, so we will leave you with a prayer in just 1 second once we get that taken care of.
Before you closed your eyes to sleep, I have a promise still to keep as I hold you in my arms. I pray your little frame grows strong and that faith takes hold while you are young. This is my prayer for you. May you trust him till the end. May you trust him in the end. This world is not it should be. But the Savior opens eyes to see all that's beautiful and true. Oh, may His light fill all you are, and the jewel of wisdom crown your heart. This is my prayer for you. Oh, hold my hand, I'll teach you the way to go. Through the joys, through the tears, the journey of these years, He is with us till the end. He is faithful till the end. Father, hear my ceaseless prayer.